his hair pops up.
And you just press that top.
Oh, okay, I'll see.
You're gonna pop up a... This one should be, yeah.
Do it
again,
yeah?
And then, yeah, just press it and then it shows up. Let me double check with the deck point if I can.
Okay. Right, so go on. You're gonna ask questions.
Yeah, let's get the drink. Come on.
Okay.
So my question is to you.
Yeah.
If no, I'm on no joke thing, serious questions, yeah?
Yeah.
No, it's no smartness, no cleverness.
That's
I'm not being a sapiosexual.
Look, we're not.
I'm just being a layman, intellectual, psychological layman.
Right, we're just here in a cafe, bro. Let's all relax, we're not speaking.
Okay, so say Jesus now, look, he's died for all everyone's sins, yeah?
Yeah.
So, for him to die for everyone's sins,
yeah.
What does that mean for our future? We sin or not, as long as we believe in Trinity, we're saved.
Okay, that's a good question.
Yeah.
Okay, so what does it mean for us? Firstly, the belief in God, even belief in...
What's that? We have sparkling and still water, Pepsi Dale, Pepsi, Pepsi Max, Fenty Mas Soda, ginger ale, ginger beer, rose lemonade, and Fever Tree lemonade.
Rose lemonade and?
Fever Tree lemonade, like simple lemonade.
What's Fever? Oh, that's simple.
Yeah, simple lemonade.
Is that all you want?
Yes, that's all the drinks you have.
Can I just have water then, please?
Yeah, still water?
Yeah.
Sure.
You sure you don't want something?
No.
What, not even to your coffee?
No. Okay. I don't have no tea. But Pakistani might be surprised because everyone...
A little bit, yeah.
24/7.
Like tea's a big thing.
Tea addictive, man. Yeah. It ages you as well.
It's true.
Not good for your skin.
That probably explains my
appearance. They put tea bags on their eyes.
Anyway, so in answer to your question. So, firstly, we got to be clear that it's the belief in Trinity. The belief in Trinity is not what saves you. There are Christians who believe that there are people that believe in the Trinity that don't follow Jesus. There are people who don't believe in the Trinity and don't follow Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. As a Christian, belief in one God is not that impressive because even the devil believes in one God.
Yes, of course. The devil believes in one God.
You know, so it's not a big deal to believe in one God. The thing is, do you give your life to Jesus? Do you follow Jesus in the way you conduct yourself?
But why don't you say his correct name? Because there's no J in Hebrew at that time.
So let me deal with the first question, then deal with the second. Right. Yeah. Okay. So in terms of what does Christ dying for all of us mean? It means simply that. There you go. In terms of what does that mean? It means that salvation is there for you. You've got it already. You just need to claim it. Let me use an analogy. It's like God has given... We are all indebted to God because we haven't lived as we should live. So we owe God a debt. Christ has paid that debt fully and completely.
So why do we... just a quick... It's not a question. Yeah, sure, it's just sure. In the discussion. Why do we owe anything to God? And, another point, why would God come down to face his own creation?
Okay, so those are two slightly separate questions.
That was just the point.
So the point is, why are we indebted to God? Because God is holy, and we should live a life that glorifies that. Holy means to be completely other from his creation.
Unique.
Yeah. And we should live a life that glorifies God's uniqueness. We should live a life that glorifies God's absolute otherness to
us. Are you saying this or are you explaining the Bible?
Just explain what the Christian scriptures teach, yes.
Black and white.
Yeah. So for example, Jesus says, be agios as your Father in heaven is agios, which means to be holy as your Father in heaven is holy. So that's the standard we're meant to live by, and no one lives by it. So there's a debt that we owe to God because we haven't lived as he wants us to live. We haven't lived by his Sharia. So in terms of what happens next, that debt is something that we don't have the ability to pay. So God himself pays it in Jesus Christ. So you've got the check in your back pocket, I've got the check in my back pocket. The difference between the Christian and the non-Christian is that the Christian has taken it out of his back pocket and cashed it at the bank. Okay. You've still got it in your back pocket.
Okay.
That's what we mean that Jesus died for everybody. So everybody has that same gift, but not everyone's cashed it.
Okay.
Now you ask the question about why does God come down and face his own creation? I want to start off by saying I agree with you completely that it is not worthy of the dignity of God that he should enter into his creation.
That's a big, very, very big thing.
Yeah.
Very significant that is.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's like me, I'm the manufacturer of something. Yeah? Only I know how to fix it.
Yeah.
So you're saying God had to sacrifice his son for and face his own creation he created in the first place.
Right, so...
So that, for me personally, that's showing, for me that's blasphemy. Why it's blasphemy for me is, you, what's his level? You're trying to show what kind of level is God? Is he almighty, powerful?
That is a great question.
For me, that's degrading God.
Allow me to respond then.
That's showing he's powerless.
Allow me to respond then, because you're absolutely right. Christians and Muslims agree, listen to this. Christian Muslims agree that God becoming man is not worthy of the dignity of God. But is where our religions are different. It's what we believe is the principal characteristic of God. We Christians believe that the principal characteristic of God is love. Now you know what love is. There's people in your life that you love, right? Now just imagine for a moment, whoever it is you love dearly, dearest in your life, whoever that is.
Yeah.
I am worthy, I would put betting money on the fact that you would be willing to crawl through a mile of shit to save them. If it meant you could save them.
But they're still human.
But you would do that,
No, but they're still human.
Would you do that?
I'm just saying, yeah.
So are you
to
saying,
a certain extent.
Are you saying that your love is greater than Allah's love?
How can that be?
Well, let's put the question another way. Does Allah love us?
Of course.
So if by becoming a man, he could save us, would he do it?
Yes, but then, okay, a man.
Now does it make sense? Well, no. Do you see where we're coming from?
We're still going to clash because why a man? You can come down as anything.
Yes.
But why a man?
Great. That's another perfectly good question.
To face his own creation. That's it. That's it. There's nothing really.
Yeah. So I don't. Why a man? Why a man? Would it be any good him becoming a sheep?
But he's God.
Would it be any good him becoming a sheep?
But he's the creator of a sheep and a man.
Yeah. But would it be any good if he's saving mankind? Does it make sense for him to become a sheep?
But then again, the process is still, the question is still going to come back to the same question again.
Yeah. The reason
why does he need to come down to face his own creation? It's still the same question then.
Because humanity is created, so let me give you the answer. For the Christian, humanity is created to glorify God. We failed to do that, but
how did we fail?
Yeah, I'm going to do that one. So, because the thing is, bro, we're having a quick conversation, but remember, this has all been recorded. So if everyone on the camera just sees you interrupting every answer to every question that you give, that's going to look bad on you.
I was kind of like a two-way one,
So, but if you ask a question, you've got to let the answer come out. So you've asked the question, why a man? It's because in the Christian worldview, we believe that humanity was created in the image of God to glorify God by living in a certain way. And God, for man to be saved, he must live that way. So Christ becomes a man so that a perfect man, so that a perfect man can meet a holy God. And then those that are in Christ, because we believe that you can be in Christ, are then saved because Christ is the perfect man. So that's why he becomes a man.
What? Says?
Says the New Testament.
Scripture. Is it in there?
Yeah, it's in there.
Okay.
I'm just giving you the summary answers because something tells me that, like, you're not here for a long Bible study, but more quick fire.
Yeah, so question and answer. Continue another time. I'll just check in my team score. All right. 6-1 Tottenham. All right.
Football before truth, people. Remember, priorities. Football because before truth.
I know what I've asked. I'm not satisfied with this because no one can ever answer. No Christian can, and I don't think they ever will. So, anyway, let's move on.
Yeah.
So from Adam, peace be upon him time, prophets that come down after him, did any of them know or forgot to preach or teach that God had a son?
Right, that's a good question. All of them taught that God would act in history through salvation. So let me just give you some examples. Okay. Adam and Eve. God speaks a prophecy to Eve that through her seed, that her son will crush the serpent's head and the serpent will bite his heel. This is what we call the proto-evangelion. It's the proto-gospel because it's the first declaration of the gospel. That through the seed of a woman, not a man, please note the difference, through the seed of a woman, that the serpent that has brought the destruction onto man will be crushed. But in that crushing, the serpent will strike the son of the woman. And this is what we see in Jesus Christ. The seed of a woman crushes the curse of the serpent, but is in doing that himself bitten by the curse. Which
it says in the Bible, yeah. I'm a research.
Yeah, it's brilliant.
That's let me research,
yeah? That's Adam and Eve. That's Adam and Eve. Okay. In Abraham,
yeah.
Abraham goes to sacrifice his son. Now, let's not quibble over who it was. Isaac or Ishmael, doesn't matter at this moment in time.
Let's forget that. That's going to go to...
But before he can kill, before he sacrifices his son, a ransom is given, a lamb is given, and is sacrificed in the stead of Ishmael, in the stead of Isaac.
So we believe that, yeah?
So we've got that concept there.
That happens, yeah.
In the New Testament, in the books of Moses, establish the idea of the Day of Atonement. The idea that God will take away the sins of his people through what? The sacrifice of a lamb. And that's what happened on the Day of Atonement. They sacrifice a lamb. Okay. And that's an essential. It's Yom Kippur, that's the Day of Atonement. So it's there in the writings of Moses. In the writings of David. In the writings of David, it talks about one who will be pierced.
The topic is God's son, yeah? We're not talking about a lamb.
But you asked me about where...
Do you understand my question? Did you understand my question? I just want to make sure we're not going off topic. My question was, from the prophet of Adam,
yeah,
all the prophets, example, like Noah, everyone was sent to a certain nation.
Yes.
Did any of them preach God has a son? Because if they knew God had a son, God, he's already eternal, isn't he?
All of them...
So were they not taught this...
Did
they not know, or God didn't tell them?
In answer to this question, directly to answer the question, but let me unpack it a bit. The answer to the question, did they teach clearly that God has a son? No, you don't see that in the Old Testament. Do they teach that there is a one coming who is the Messiah, who will be the savior of his people? Yes, they teach this.
Who,
and in the new, exactly. Yeah, and this figure who is the Messiah who will save his people is Yeshua, Jesus Christ. You believe that he's the Messiah. In the Quran, he's called the Messiah. Have you never wondered why Jesus alone is called the Messiah and no one else in the Quran?
Okay, as the Quran, we believe every soul should taste death, yeah?
Yes.
So Jesus is the only one, as we believe, that didn't die. So once she tastes death, no one's coming back.
Okay.
So for me, it makes sense logically. This is why Jesus is the only prophet that's coming back. Isa bin Ibn Maryam is the only one coming back.
Yeah.
Because as I believe, as a Muslim, every soul will taste death. Once you're gone, you're not coming back.
Yeah.
Even though Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is the seed of prophets, no one's gonna come after him. But I'm just going to talk about our belief quickly. Yeah? Isa ibn Maryam is going to come with no new religion, same Prophet Sallallahu's religion, and he is going to say to people like you, the Christians, I don't know you. So we stick on the Bible. I just want to just, if you didn't know this.
Yeah, I actually.
You do know what I'm saying.
I do know what you're saying. But do you know that there are lots of Muslims that reject those hadiths that those beliefs are based on?
They can't
Sunni
be Muslims.
I'm talking about Sunni
they
Muslims.
They can't be Muslims.
Mufti Menk, who's a British Mufti.
Mufti Menk?
Menk, yeah.
Can't be Mufti Menk. No, we're impossible.
He's a Muslim scholar. He's a Muslim scholar. Educated. Let me finish.
You've got the wrong name, I'm just
saying. He's a Muslim scholar. Well,
I know you talk about it, it's from Birmingham.
Maybe. He does not believe that Jesus is coming back.
He's gone. He's gone from the fold.
But this is my point.
I'm just keeping it real, isn't it? I'm just trying to keep it real. You mentioned someone, yeah?
This conversation has the risk of just floating everywhere. Let's just stick
to it. No, it hasn't. You have to name me someone who, like, example, if you say...
I've just given you one.
If you say to me, like, you mentioned the wrong one, you got it twisted, yeah?
No, I mentioned someone that you don't...
Let me tell you what would be better. First, you have to say to me, do you follow and accept Mufti Lev? Then we can carry that on. If I'm telling you he's not a Muslim, he's gone. If he said that, he's gone from the fold of Islam, yeah? The mainstream, he's gone. I'm Ahlus Sunnah wal Jamaah. So you need to ask me something.
Yeah.
This scholar, do you accept him? Do you follow him? Because as a Christian, you got certain scholars you follow and reject yourself. Am I right or wrong?
What I'm going to do is I'm going to return to the essential topic of the conversation. which is that in the Old Testament, it speaks about a coming figure who is the Messiah. The New Testament is very clear, Jesus is that Messiah. The Quran is also very clear, Jesus is that Messiah. But if you look at that Messiah figure in the Old Testament, he's more than a prophet. He's a cosmological figure that has equality with God. And I can show you in the Old Testament. Now, I'm asking you, have you ever stopped and wondered why does the Quran call Jesus alone the Messiah? Why doesn't it call Muhammad the Messiah or David
the Messiah? If we talk about the Old Testament, but the Jews reject that, don't they?
I'm asking you.
A simple question. Do they reject it? Or accept?
Do the Jews reject the idea of the Messiah? No. Do they reject the idea of the Messiah being a cosmological figure? No. Do they reject Jesus as the Messiah? Yes.
Okay.
But that means they're rejecting what the Quran says and what the New Testament says.
But you're quoting from the Old Testament.
I am quoting from the Old Testament.
So the Jews didn't follow it, did they? They didn't accept it, did they?
Exactly, and this is why we Christians
yes.
don't okay. pin our religion to what the Jews say.
Okay, now did Jesus say, I have come for the lost sheep of Israel to fulfill the law? So what does that mean? Well, He Jesus said, I've only come to fulfill the law. No, nothing else. Simple, straight, black and white. Jesus said, I've only come to fulfill the law.
Right, this
then four gospels come out. We've got some John guy, we've got some Mark, Matthew, Luke, we've got some everything according to. No one knows their background. Who's the only disciple that saw? So let me tell you something. I've studied the Bible, yeah?
No offense. Wait. Are you making...
I'm making a point, then I'm going to let you answer.
Okay, so, but it's the point I understand, the point that I get, it's like, but I just want to point out something.
Okay.
That you have made the point that Jesus... You've conflated two verses, by the way. You've conflated two separate verses. But you've made the point that Jesus said, I have come for none but other than the house of Israel, which is true. That's exactly what Jesus came to do. And that Jesus himself said, that you know, neither no jot or tittle shall be abolished from the law until this is a bit Muslims always leave out.
Let's go.
They always leave this bit out.
Correct me.
It doesn't suit them.
I'm happy to be correct.
Until all has been fulfilled, which means that there is a condition upon which the law isn't abolished, but the law ceases to be as they understand it.
And what's the conditions?
The coming of the Messiah.
Okay, and where does it say that?
Okay, so you look at the Old Testament, you look at the covenant of Israel, okay?
Yes.
The covenant of Israel was given by God to Moses and to the 12 tribes of Israel about how they should live, right?
Yes.
But then, within the literature of the Old Testament, it speaks about the Messiah, this cosmological figure who will rule the world.
Okay.
So the law was given to Israel to how Israel will be governed. But the Messiah is going to be the king of the world, which means that the law that is applied to Israel doesn't apply to the rest of the world. Even the Jews will tell you that, which means that the Messiah is doing something bigger than the law. So when the Messiah comes, the law is absorbed into a new covenant.
So it's a new covenant, yeah?
Because Jesus is the king of the world. And the world is bigger than Israel. Agreed?
Okay.
Yeah. So this is why Jesus fulfills the law in his coming. And the laws of Moses are transformed in the teachings of Jesus. Yeah?
Okay.
Now, in terms of your point about him coming only to the house of Israel, he does only come to the house of Israel.
Gentiles, yeah?
He does only come to the house of Israel.
Okay.
But in the course of his ministry, he blesses, he heals a centurion servant, he heals the daughter of a Samaritan woman.
No, but we believe that, with the permission of Allah, yes.
Yeah. So he performs all of these miracles, which means that the blessings of the Messiah are not just for the house of Israel. And then at the end of his time, he commands the apostles to go out into the entire world, teaching and baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and making all the nations disciples of him. So at the end of his ministry, he commands the church to go into the world.
So let me just get this correct. Jesus is the author.
Author of what?
The Old Testament.
Then
Jesus comes himself. Let me just get it correct, yeah?
No.
He's not the author of the five books of Moses.
Yeah.
Sorry. He's not the author.
No, it's the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
He's the Holy Spirit?
No, the Holy Spirit is the author.
The Holy Spirit is the author?
Correct.
Okay, but they're all one, isn't it?
They're one, yeah, they're
one with three different essence.
No, that's not what we believe.
That's not what you believe, okay.
No. So Christians believe that there's only one God.
One God.
Okay. That this God has always, and this is really important, has always existed as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's not a point at which they became Father.
So you believe in the first commandment?
Yeah, of course. So in the same way, for instance, in the same way, like just to use an analogy, here you've got a vat of water. If I pour this one vat of water,
I'll give you a better one, ice.
One second. If I pour ice. This one vat of water into three separate ice. Glasses, ice. How many drinks do I have?
No, hold on. I'm not going to speak. Go soon. I interrupted you. I just thought ice would help you better.
No. So in terms of this analogy, because Muslims often confuse themselves into thinking that three can't be one and one can't be three. If I take this one vase of water and I put it into three glasses, do I have one drink or do I have three drinks? In the sense that they are in three different glasses, I have three drinks. In the sense that it's the same substance in every glass, I have one drink. The property of the water in this glass is no different from the one in that one, and is no different from the one in that one. It's the same.
But one thing you got to understand is, yeah, if you, like, just so you're gonna, let's forget Muslim, yeah. Let's just say we're trying to preach to an atheist. You are.
I do.
Often. What I'm trying to say is, it's gonna be like this. Look, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. It's always gonna be like that, no matter how much you try to explain it.
What about it? There's no problem.
It's always gonna be like that. One, two, three. It's always gonna happen.
What's the problem with that, sorry?
Because it's always going to sound the Trinity equals three.
No, that's just...
Now, how much do you... However you try to prove it...
No.
It's still going to be three.
No. I'm sorry.
What do you think?
I'm neutral, sound, bro. I'm neutral.
Excuse me, sir.
It's always going to happen.
I'm neutral, brother.
Can I get some more hot water for my tea, please? Yeah, please. So let's leave that. No, we're not going to leave it.
I want to
address that point. Okay. Sorry, just halfway, please.
Sure.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So let's just address this point. Because I think because it's such a contentious point, it's worth digging into.
Yeah.
So I want to give you certain proofs that demonstrate that three can be one and one can be three. Okay? These are not disputable proofs.
Okay.
So I don't know if you're any good at maths, but if I have infinity and I add to it infinity and then I add infinity again, what does it equal?
Infinity.
Thank you.
If, that's one second. That's the analogy you're giving for
one second.
God.
One
second. Different
one second.
God.
That's what you. It parallels exactly what you've done. You've done one, two, three. I've done infinity plus infinity plus infinity.
You divide it by three.
Infinity divided by three still equals infinity. Exactly. So the point is God infinite? Yes. So that's a better analogy than the one you're using. Secondly, the triple point of water. Do you know what the triple point of water is? Every chemical substance has what's called a triple point. Depending on the pressure that you give to it and the temperature that it's under, it will display simultaneously the attributes of gaseous, solidious, and liquid form. Okay. Triple, you can see that for yourself.
My point to you is
that lots of Muslims think that they're making an intelligent point when they go 1 + 1 + 1 = 3.
No, it's not.
It's neither an intelligible point to Christianity, nor is it an accurate description of what Christians believe.
Okay.
It's just something that Muslims say to themselves. And Muslims like saying it to themselves, but it's not what Christians believe. It doesn't reflect what Christians believe. Because we believe in one God. Right? If you walk away and you learn
nothing else today, do you and Jesus believe in the same God? You and the Jews?
Yeah.
You believe in the same God?
We believe in the same God.
But they don't have the same concept as we do.
Well, they don't now, but if you look at Philo, do you know the writings of Philo?
No.
So the writings of Philo were written before Jesus Christ, right? And Philo speaks about the Logos of God being the active force, the active persona of God's activity in the world. Later scholars called it the theology of the two powers. So he's describing that God through his word is active in ordering the world. He associated it with reason in Philo's literature. So actually Philo, he was a Jew before Jesus Christ was born, is someone who actually talks in the same language as later Christians did.
Aramaic.
No, I'm talking about in theological language.
Oh, okay.
The idea of the Logos being God's activity in the world.
Oh, yeah.
And that's from Philo, which is before Christianity. So there was a time when Jews did believe in this plurality within the divinity.
So what happened?
Great question. What happened? Why don't you speak like that today? Because of 2,000 years, not 2,000, of about, because of about 1,600 years of Christian persecution has meant that and the fact that Christians evangelized amongst the Jews, which meant that the Jews had to find a way of being Jewish that could resist that kind of attempt at converting them to Christianity.
Then can we agree on one thing? It don't matter. It don't matter what religion we are, what color we are, what culture we are, there's evil and good everywhere.
Yeah, I agree with that.
We can agree with that.
I can agree with that.
One more is, you know, remember last week you spoke about the Holy Spirit, yeah?
Yeah.
John 16:13?
Yeah.
The Spirit of Truth, yeah?
Yeah. The pneumata is here.
So we know the Holy Spirit is eternal, so he already exists. But this is actually a prophecy saying someone to come. And if he hasn't come, that means there's still a prophecy to be fulfilled.
Okay.
If we are like, let's just say someone's interested in Christianity.
Yeah.
I'm your assistant now. I'm going to try and help you out. Yeah.
Yeah.
How can I explain John 16:13? Because before 16:13, in 14:17, it very clearly shows the Holy Spirit is already there. So yeah. If you read before the verse,
yeah.
It's already there.
Yeah.
So how do we explain? It says, there's so many, I'm paraphrasing, yeah? So many things to say.
Yeah.
You can't bear now. The Spirit of Truth will come and, oh well, I don't remember the whole verse, but.
Yeah.
So you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I do. I really do, because I've heard this a lot. So if we turn to John.
It's a lot, but it's what we take from it and what exactly. We understand from it.
So let's, I mean, just follow me if you want. John.
No, I'm not. I'm just looking at my other notes.
You're looking at your WhatsApp.
I'm looking at your WhatsApp. You have to catch my attention, innit, first?
Yeah.
Big up Miles Davis on the beat.
Or you could just be present to the conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's also.
No, because I've mentioned that, of course, I'm only be listening. So. No, I can multitask, sorry.
Okay. Anyway, so. Let's also agree that the same scripture that you're quoting clearly identifies the Spirit of Truth as the Holy Spirit. Because it says, these things I have spoken to you while abiding with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. Now let me ask you this question, because I get the feeling that you're implying that this is Muhammad, is that correct?
No, carry on.
Okay.
Prove what
you've got to prove. If as Muslims, some Muslims like to claim, because the most intelligent Muslims have now abandoned...
Let's stay on a verse.
Because
like, if you ask me a verse about the Quran, I'm not going to go to another Quran verse to explain that verse. Because this is what I realise about Christians, yeah? Let's stay on the verse.
Yes, let's.
Let's stay on the verse.
So this verse sits within a continuous monologue given by Jesus. It's a speech.
Says who?
The Gospel of John that you're quoting.
So I gave you that verse, so can we stay on that verse? That means you're going to another verse to explain.
Let's see this. Okay, so let's stick with just this verse.
Verse have you gone on?
Because firstly, I'm going to explain the verse properly. Because the thing is, this is exactly why Muslims don't increase in knowledge.
Because you're trying to explain the Bible. Is it ambiguous verse? Well, is it ambiguous or not?
Is it
black and white clear or...?
The people that are seeing on the live stream is that you're asking one question and you're interrupting the answer and asking another question.
But I have to, because if I'm asking, I don't want to waste time.
Do you want to... less time would be wasted.
Time is wasted, because if you're saying Surah 5:3 and I've gone to
less
53...
Less time would be wasted if you interrupted less. You might find that there's an answer given if you allow
it. I told you already, I'm a intellectual, psychological, I'm a layman.
Okay.
So
let's bear with me,
this verse. Bear with me, I'm a layman.
Christ speaks, he gives a moniker to the character that he's describing. He calls him the Pneumater Zalerthios. So a logical mind, since this is one continuous speech that goes over three chapters of the Gospel of John, would look to other places where that moniker, the Spirit of Truth, is given. And we find that Spirit of Truth is given in verse 16 of chapter 14. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of Truth. So we've identified the same moniker, the same character earlier in this passage.
No, but can you carry on reading 16?
And then, that same moniker of that same character is identified in verse 25, as these things I have spoken to you while abiding with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit. So he's identifying as the Holy Spirit,
yeah.
And he says that the Holy Spirit will come in the name of Jesus. That eliminates Muhammad, because Muhammad came in the name of Allah.
Can I see it? It
yes, of course, absolutely.
So, come. See, I'll actually spat 1614. So
there you go. We'll come to 1614. I'm just building up to it. There it is. It says it right there, that the Holy Spirit will come in the name of Jesus.
All right.
What does it say? What does it say? He will...
Okay, do you know what you just showed me then?
Yeah.
You showed me a clear contradiction.
No, one second. It says here...
That's what you just done.
It says here...
If you go to another... You're going to show me three contradictions now. But carry on.
Whom the Father will send in my name.
Okay.
So what is the name of the person speaking?
I'm just concentrating on the verse I asked you.
Remember
my question. I asked you a simple question about John. And yes. I said, the Holy Spirit was already there. He says someone to come. So that's a prophecy. Do we agree that's a prophecy?
Mm-hmm.
So is that prophecy being fulfilled?
Yes.
Or is it still to be fulfilled?
No, it's fulfilled. It's been fulfilled. It was fulfilled 2,000 years ago when the Holy Spirit came to the church.
But he's already there.
Right. So let us
address. He's eternal.
Let us address that point. So we've identified that the Holy Spirit is the equivalent of the Spirit of Truth, and that the Holy Spirit is coming in the name of Jesus, which immediately eliminates Muhammad, because Muhammad came in the name of Allah. It also says that when the Helper comes, I will send to you from the Father. So Jesus is the one sending the Helper. Ask yourself, did Jesus send Muhammad? No, you don't believe that. Allah sent Muhammad. Now, coming to your passage, coming to the bit that you wanted to focus in on. I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. But when he, the Pneuma Teresalertheos, the Spirit of Truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak of his own initiative. Whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come. He will glorify me.
Yes, which Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did.
No.
Anyway, coming on.
One second.
Let's carry on.
You've got that wrong. He will glorify me. The word there is doxa. It's where we get the word orthodoxy from.
Okay.
Doxa is an act of worship. Muhammad doesn't worship Jesus, but the Holy Spirit says that he will guide people to worship Jesus, to glorify Jesus. So that's not Muhammad.
Okay.
Then it goes on to say, for he will take of mine. Muhammad doesn't claim to take of Jesus's words. He claims Muhammad's. He claims Allah's words, not Jesus's words.
Okay.
But the one who's coming, he will take of mine and will disclose it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Jesus has just claimed equality with Allah. He said, all things that Allah has are mine. And then he goes on to say, therefore I said to you that he takes of mine and will disclose it to you. So the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit
are
all God. Yes, absolutely, of course.
Let's read it. So when I read something, I'm going to start from 16. Yeah? What did I say? 1614. Show me where I'm reading from.
The passage that you want is there.
Is this one 12? Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna read 12 onwards. Yeah.
Okay.
And the context. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm not gonna turn pages, jump left, right, and center.
Which I didn't do.
Okay. I have many more things to say to you, but cannot bear them now.
Yeah.
But when he, so who's he?
The Holy Spirit.
1 minute. The Holy Spirit's already there. He's eternal, right?
Yeah.
According to Christians, yeah.
Yeah.
The Spirit of Truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth.
Correct.
For he will not speak on his own initiative.
Brilliant. Yep.
Because everyone will decide itself, innit? You just got to read the passage, got to use a bit of intelligence.
You mean, literally, I've just read the passage reading the passage.
He will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Initiative. But whatever he hears, remember, yeah?
Yeah.
He will speak.
Yeah.
And so you're talking about this, so you're still saying it's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes to speak.
No, the Bible says it's the Holy Spirit, it's not me.
No.
We
just stick on this passage.
Yeah.
First we just stick on this.
The Bible says that's the Holy Spirit.
He will disclose
it right there.
He will disclose to you. Will speak. And he will He will disclose to you what is to come. So
correct.
To come means the future.
Yep.
A prophecy.
Yep.
It's basic. Children will understand that.
Yep.
Even kids will know this.
The Agios Panuma does
give. He will glorify me, and for he will take of mine and will disclose to you.
Yeah.
So simple. A revelation to come from God.
Mm-hmm.
this is what it means. Yeah. Because who's me? Jesus is God, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we'll disclose it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Right. So,
could a prophet say that?
Hold on. You just said they're all one, isn't it?
Could a prophet say that?
Hold on a minute. You said they're all one, so let's keep it as one.
Could a prophet say that?
Let me just finish. Therefore, I said that he takes of mine and will disclose it to you. So let's just leave it as that.
That's exactly what I did.
So we just leave it.
So the thing is,
I just wanted to clear up so I can understand it. Yeah. So if I'm missing out something, I just want to understand that verse.
Yeah. So this verse can't be Muhammad for multiple reasons. But let's address two points that you made. Firstly, the fact that the Holy Spirit was already there, and the fact that the Holy Spirit is eternal. Because when it says that the Holy Spirit will come, that shouldn't be confused with saying that the Holy Spirit will be created, because that's not what it's saying.
And no one's saying that
the Holy Spirit
will come. I'm just reading.
But then you pointed out rightly that the Holy Spirit is already there, and you're quite right. The Bible says that. It says it in verse 16. I will ask the Father, and He will give you another Helper.
We're on John, isn't it?
This isn't yet John 14.
Was John a disciple?
Let me just finish this point, and then ask a question. I will ask the Father, and He will give you another Helper, that He may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not see Him or know Him. But you know Him, because He abides with you and will be in you. So here's the thing. Here's the dilemma solved.
Yeah.
Firstly, the apostles at the time already know the Spirit of Truth. Well, the apostles at the time of Jesus didn't know Muhammad, so that can't be Muhammad. It also says that the Holy Spirit will be in you.
But you're still not sticking on the same
which is will be in you, and it's in that sense really that the riddle of the Islamic script is solved. Because Muslims say, well, how, if that's the Holy Spirit was already there, correct, but the Holy Spirit was not there in them. So when it talks
to them,
when it says to them that the Spirit will be in you, that it is in that sense that Christ is speaking here in verse 12 of 16, that the Holy Spirit will come. Because it is a coming to a different purpose, a coming to a different thing. The thing is, bro, what you've got the opportunity to do now is a real Bible study.
No.
As opposed to just
I've already
the
read
repetition
the Bible.
Of a script.
Let me just tell you, I didn't come prepared for this. Like I just said, I'll pass him through.
Fair enough.
I just remembered you said that last week, And I didn't come with no notes.
Yeah.
For me, this is light work. This is a quick light work for
sure.
Me. Okay? So, if I do, next time we have a proper one,
let's
I have
do
my
that.
Notes.
Yep.
I have evidence.
Let's do a
and then
study.
We sit down. We analyze it.
Yep.
We see the evidence, and let's
how
then,
about,
then we can progress.
How about me and you do a Bible study of John chapter 16, the whole chapter?
No problem.
Yeah. You can
no
bring
issues.
Your notes, and we're going to sit together, and we're going to study just John chapter 16, and no other chapter, just that one.
I'm going to speak about everything about John. We're going to know who John is first.
Yeah.
We're going to have to know about John's network, tree, family. Who was he?
Yeah.
Was he a disciple?
So let me
because it's very important. These kind of things are very important to me.
Yeah.
So why they're important to me? Because I can't quote someone that I don't know nothing about. It's like me saying, I'll give you an example. A Quranist, that rejects Hadith, example. Now, for them to believe Muhammad, peace be upon him, brought the last revelation and he's the seal, no one to come after him. But then they don't want to, then if they just accept the Quran, they're gonna know nothing about Muhammad. They're gonna know his family. They're gonna know the Sahaba's names. They're gonna know. Do you get my point now?
Yeah.
They don't know nothing about him.
Which is why I reject the Quran.
No, I'm talking about Quranists. It's nothing to do with it.
What's the name of your God?
Allah.
Allah's not a name.
Go on.
Allah is a contraction of Al-Illah.
So why do Christian Arabs say Allah? You know Christian Arabs.
But they don't
Allah.
Use it as a name.
Okay.
They use it in the same way that the English use God. God is not a name.
No, why we don't use God?
No,
because
I'm
let me see why.
You, what is the name of your
I'm
God?
Trying to say, because Allah can't be Allah's.
Agreed.
God can be God's.
Right.
Agreed?
Well, Allah's in that
no,
sense.
No, God's could be God's.
You could pluralize.
This is why we don't use the word God. This is why when we say there is no God but Allah for
a
reason.
There is a plurality.
Do you understand? There's a reason why we say that.
You can pluralize Allah. in Arabic.
Ella.
You can't pluralize Ella, Ella in Arabic.
Ella. So you can pluralize we're talking about gods, yeah? God?
I think it's...
God can be gods.
Ilamin.
That explains Trini.
No, so...
Anyway.
So the thing is, you're saying it's really important that we know all this about John. You don't even know the name of your God. Your God has never given you a name.
All right. Allah, yeah?
But Allah is not a name. Allah doesn't even claim that Allah
can
is
Allah
a name.
Can Allah be Allah's?
Allahs can be Allah. You can pluralize Allah.
Prove that to me. Were you saying this one?
The term Allah can be pluralized like any term in Arabic can be pluralized.
Prove to me it's that just, you have you ever heard anyone call Allah?
It's just,
have you ever heard a singular?
Yes.
Wait, hold on. Feminine or male?
What was the name of Muhammad's father?
Abdullah.
Abdullah. What does Abdullah mean in English?
I don't know, educated.
In slave of Allah.
Okay.
So there was an Allah before Muhammad's Allah.
No. I tell you why.
So why was Muhammad's father called Allah?
Let me teach you something.
Okay, go on.
Yeah. Every prophet came with the same message. La ilaha illallah. And do you know what that message is? Oh. From Adam, peace be upon him.
Excuse me. Sorry. Can I get more sugar, please?
Sugar, yeah?
Please.
From Adam... I'm just going to teach you something you don't know. Maybe you do know about Islam. Adam, peace be upon him.
You're teaching me on the camera.
No. I'm addressing him so he's listening. I'm making sure he's listening as well.
He's listening.
Okay. Adam, peace be upon him, to the time of Isa ibn Maryam, they all preached La ilaha illallah. There is no God but Allah. Yeah? Then when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, it changed. Then it come to La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, the final slave and messenger. So, according to me, where I stand, where my belief is, every prophet preached the same message, La ilaha illallah.
Okay, may I reply?
Yeah. So, there's no God but Allah.
May I
so,
reply? Yeah, go on. Okay. Now, please note, I didn't continuously interrupt you.
You're a good man.
Yeah. Okay, so my point to
you
I'll
give you the reins.
My point to you is this. The fact is that there's clear evidence, even within Islamic literature, that Allah was a pagan god. Because Muhammad's father was called, I'm going to give you my evidence right now.
Okay.
Within a heartbeat of the same sentence that you interrupted, that Muhammad's father, by Muslim sources, without any prompting from me, you even confirmed this, is called Abdullah. Abdullah means slave of Allah. So that means that Allah was a term used by pagans before Muhammad. Which means that there were other gods called Allah before Muhammad.
Can you prove it?
I've just given you my evidence.
That's not evidence.
And you confirmed it as well.
No, I didn't.
Well, okay, well, people can make their own mind up.
Now, Adam, peace be upon him.
Let me finish.
Okay, from Adam, please. Remember, I'm a layman, by the way. Yeah?
So let me finish.
Adam, peace be upon him.
Let me finish, bro. Please, let me finish. Let me finish my point. Now, you claim, and Muslims always make this claim, that every prophet taught the same religion. What bogus nonsense. There's no evidence of that. The prophets of the Old Testament.
The prophets of the Old Testament taught
things that Muhammad never taught. They taught a Sabbath. They taught a temple. They taught temple sacrifice. Jesus taught a Sabbath. Taught a temple. Taught a temple sacrifice. He saw it completed in him. Hence, the law was fulfilled. Islam has no concept of a Sabbath, and it has no concept of a temple, and it has no concept of a temple sacrifice. Jews believe that God tabernacles with his people. Yeah. Christians believe that God tabernacles with his people. Muslims say that God can't enter creation at all. So Muslims and Jews and Christians preach the same religion. Islam doesn't preach the same religion as the Jews.
You can go to the famous one, Deuteronomy 18:18 on that. Yeah? Because we can look at a comparison on that.
Yeah.
But before I do that, you still ain't answered the question. I said from Adam, peace be upon him, from all the prophets down, from all the prophets that come for their different times, different nations, did anyone know God had a son?
I did actually answer that question.
You think you did, but let's move on.
I did answer that question very directly, and people who are watching this can make their own mind up. But
let's go to 18:18.
Deuteronomy
it's been done so many times over and over again, but the people that want to seek the truth, like Jesus says, the truth will set you free. But that's what happens. And if you're going to be closed in the verse, then you're just going to be in the same boat.
Yeah. Let's just.
So I'm trying to float your boat.
Let's just have a look where it talks about. Because in the book of Acts, it's really clear.
No, I didn't ask for that.
Yeah.
Ask me. Okay, we're not gonna do Quran today. We don't have time. But ask me a verse of Quran. We're gonna go straight to the Quran, straight to that verse. We're gonna stick to it. If we have to read it a verse before or after, we will stick on the same context and topic. No one spoke about Acts. So that's the thing. This is how you've been taught. So because you've been taught like this, this is why you're finding it difficult. You stay on one verse.
I mean, people can make their own mind up whether I'm finding it difficult. There's no need for commentary. That's all right. You're entitled to your opinion. I'm entitled to disagree. In terms of Deuteronomy 18:18, that verse is clearly not talking about Muhammad for a number of reasons. One, Muhammad wasn't a Jew. Two, Muhammad didn't speak in the name of Yahweh. Okay. It's that verse clearly states that the prophet, like unto Moses, will come from amongst your brethren. That is not Muhammad. And that same Hebrew term, that same Hebrew term from amongst your brethren that's used in chapter 18 is
used. Can you explain what brethren means? What does brethren mean?
I compliment my audience with my intelligence. In terms of Deuteronomy 18:18, that same verse from amongst your brethren is used in chapter 17 when it says that you shall appoint a king over you from amongst your brethren. Now that is obviously a statement about Jews appointing a Jewish king over them. And if it meant that there, then it means in Deuteronomy 18 that the prophet will be from amongst their brethren. It's the same phrase.
Remember, key word, amongst their brethren.
I don't think you even listen to what
you mentioned. Gentiles. Yeah?
What did I say What did I say about Deuteronomy 17?
I'm gonna read that as well.
What did I? No, hold on. You were apparently listening. Okay, what did I say about Deuteronomy 17? What did I say?
I'm gonna read it.
Well, I'm just asking what I said. You weren't listening, were you?
Okay.
You weren't listening. Be honest. You weren't listening, were you?
Because I've listened. I know, innit? You know, because I asked you about 18:18.
Correct.
So you need to stay on what I asked you. Remember that.
So you weren't listening to what I said.
No. Because
so you don't even know if what I said was relevant.
No. Because you're not listening.
Question.
If I'm asking you something,
yeah.
If I'm talking about football and you start talking about cricket, it's not happening.
Right. In Deuteronomy, just to prove my point, everyone who's watching at home, get out your Bibles and look at Deuteronomy 17, verse 14.
And remember, Jesus is not a prophet, according to him.
When you enter the land which the Lord your God gives you, and you possess it and live in it.
So this is 18:18.
And you say, I will set a king over me, it's like all the nations who are around me, you shall surely set a king over you, whom the Lord your God chooses, one from amongst your countrymen.
Is that 18:18?
So that's the exact same Hebrew phrase that appears in Deuteronomy 18:18, where it says, the Lord said to me.
Wow, that's how difficult the Bible is. You have to go to so many verses to explain simple verse.
I'm not going to talk over you. If you don't want to have a conversation, you can just stop.
It's not that. No, we'll finish it. I'm just getting stressed out. I need a cigarette. You're making me feel like I'm ignorant.
With the utmost respect, when it comes to the Bible, you are ignorant.
That's what I'm saying. I've got to have a cigarette now. Don't stress me. All right.
Yeah?
Try and help me stop smoking.
In Deuteronomy 18.
Let's just stick to 18:18.
Which is the passage you want to go to. I'll just read from verse 17. The Lord said to me, they have spoken well, and I will raise up a prophet from amongst their countrymen.
Jesus is not a prophet.
So,
according to him.
So, no, actually we believe that Jesus is a prophet.
He's a prophet
listen.
Now.
You should listen.
God, we don't know.
Yeah. A prophet is an office.
Okay.
Like a president.
So now he's
or
a prophet.
A prime minister. No.
Okay,
we're not now.
I've never heard you once
it.
Ever said that.
Well, maybe you should pay more attention. The reality is being a prophet is an office. It's like being a president or a prime minister or a king.
Okay.
So anyone can enter the office of a prophet.
So as soon as we went to his verse, it's all about prophet now. Alright, let's carry on.
Yeah. So Deuteronomy 18:18 is using the exact same Hebrew phrase of Deuteronomy 17:17. And when in Deuteronomy 17:17 it talks about from amongst your countrymen, there's no dispute. That's a Jew. So why would you dispute it in Deuteronomy 18?
So you're explaining 18? It again, yeah? Are you explaining it or are you reading it?
Do you want me to read it again?
No, because you're explaining it. Can I read it?
You weren't listening the first time.
Can I read it?
Go on.
I will raise
yep.
up
yep.
for them
yep.
a prophet
Brilliant.
like you from among. What does among mean?
Among, from within.
They are fellow Israelites.
Yeah, there you
fellow.
Go.
What does fellow mean?
Fellow Israelites. It means
brethren, fellow. What does it mean?
There's no need to shout.
No, I was making sure he hears.
I'm sure he can hear. He's only 1 foot away. He's not deaf. He's only 1 foot away.
No. Okay,
yeah, go on. I'm loving the jazz music. Go on.
That's exactly what I was thinking of.
It was Miles Davis before. It was Miles Davis. Big up Miles Davis.
He is zoned out.
I'm on point. Believe me, I'm on point. Yeah. I was thinking, hold on. I'll listen to the tune first. Yeah, I was thinking, come on. The tune.
Okay.
I will raise. These are so many translations, and this ain't no anti. I don't need no anti-Christianity. No, I don't need none of that. Yeah.
Okay.
You can see yourself. I'm in the Bible, but there's no anti. Oh, I don't need no help from no one.
Okay.
Yeah. I've got. Allah gave me a brain, and I'm using it.
Great.
I will raise up a prophet like you from amongst their fellow Israelites. I will put my words into his mouth, and he will tell people everything I command him. Okay? I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers.
Yep.
What seed was Jesus? Was he David's seed?
He was born of Isaac and Jacob.
So he carried on. Was he David's seed?
Yeah, he was David's seed by Mary.
So was Moses from David? Are they from the same line?
Yeah, they're from the same line, Isaac and Jacob.
So is Jesus then, yeah?
Yes.
Amongst their brothers. Alright, let's go. Let's carry on. This is the final one. The New King James Version. I will raise up from a prophet like you from amongst their brethren. What does brethren mean?
It means from amongst your brothers.
No, it doesn't.
Yeah, it does.
Does it? Okay, it does. When I asked a Jew this, when he explained the Jews to me this verse, because Jews tell the truth, yeah. Orthodox ones, the strict, you know, the ones that actually follow it. They said, we believe you are our cousins. Muslims.
Yeah, cousins are not brothers though.
No. I'm just told you what a Jew said to me, an Orthodox Jew. And will put my words in his mouth.
He wouldn't have said that to you, because you're a Pakistani.
He knew what I meant. Ishmaelites.
No. And
so not. Basically the Jew knew what I meant. He knew Ishmael. Ishmael and Isaac.
No, he didn't. He wouldn't have said that to you.
All right, anyway.
Because Jews think ethnically. And you think religiously because you're a Muslim, but a Jew thinks ethnically because he's a Jew.
So everyone just remember, prophet. Just remember,
are we having a conversation now?
I was making sure he's not listening to the jazz.
Oh, you're not talking
to me. No, I'm not anymore.
You're not on the jazz no more, yeah?
Okay. Right. Guys, I'll let him complete his lecture. I'm just going to enjoy my tea and leave. I'm not needed here anymore.
No, because I just told you, today's light work. Yeah, so when I come in my books.
Oh, now you want to talk to me.
No, because when I come in my notes.
So bro.
And my seasons, we can arrange another time.
Let's
remember, today was a quick thing. Remember, I probably used 1% of my brain today.
Bro, in Acts
Trust
chapter
me,
3.
I'm lightheaded.
In Acts chapter 3, verse 17, reads this.
No, even not.
And this is Peter speaking. And now, brethren.
Yes, I like Peter.
And now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance just as your rulers did also, for the things which God announced beforehand by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. He has thus fulfilled, therefore repent and return, so that your sins may be wiped away, in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus the Christ, appointed for you, whom heaven must receive until the period of restoration of all things, about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from ancient times. Moses said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from amongst your brethren. Him you shall give heed to everything he says to you, and will be that every soul that does not heed that prophet shall be utterly destroyed from amongst
and
the people.
The author of that's Jesus as well.
So Peter.
It's funny, isn't it?
So Peter.
Sometimes people are just funny.
So Peter is saying that Christ Jesus is the fulfillment of Deuteronomy 18:18.
Okay.
And he was a Jew who lived at the time of Jesus.
So he knows Hebrew better than you. He knows the scriptures better than you. He knew Jesus better than you.
Yep.
And he's saying that Jesus fulfills that prophecy, not Muhammad. So Deuteronomy 18 is a bad place to go.
Now you and I know, forget what Peter says now, yeah? You and I know, I've never ever heard you, I've never heard a Christian at Speaker's Corner talk about Jesus as a prophet, ever. Because when I put that verse out, you flip.
No, just take the bill, please. Thank you.
I think he's taking notice. Like he wants to learn as well. Good, yeah.
Nothing to worry about. Nothing else.
I feel interested. Just to learn. Please.
Thank you.
Okay.
I think he's inclining towards me because he keeps coming past my side first.
Bro, so what I'm saying to you, right, is that, and this is what I say to you, is what
we carry on next time.
What I would say to you, bro, and what I would say to every Muslim. Is simply that the kind of arguments that you come out with, we get on camera again and again, week after week after week. And it isn't because people have studied, it's because people have imbibed a script. They've imbibed, meaning that they've absorbed it consciously or unconsciously, deliberately or unwittingly, they have imbibed a script. And that script is a complete misdirection played on Muslims by other Muslims about Christianity. You owe it to yourself to learn Christianity with a
You don't know, that's what I'm saying. Remember, let me tell you something, yeah? You don't know about me. Well, I know about you, because always remember one thing, yeah? Never underestimate your opponent. So tell you why, because you don't know nothing about me. And remember, I know about you.
Brilliant.
So always remember that. So give me some, I'm just giving you some advice. When I do come with my notes.
Yeah, great, come with your notes.
And
just so you know, I'm not working from notes.
Pardon?
I'm working from notes.
You're the man, I'm a layman.
It's a here.
I'm a layman. I keep saying to you, I'm trying to humble myself. I don't know. I'm a layman.
But if you're
the man. But remember,
if you're
working from there.
So what you've got to do is you've got to read Deuteronomy 18 and read Deuteronomy 17. Okay, read those two things together because the same Hebrew.
Not Acts, yes? Not Acts. Remember, you went to Acts, then you went to Peter as well.
No, to explain.
Deuteronomy 18.
You weren't following me because I went to Acts and Acts quotes Peter. That's what I said. I didn't go to Peter.
All right, so my mistake.
You're not listening.
Mistake.
Yeah, that's fine. So you've got to read for your homework. Yeah.
No homework. I don't even know. Homework.
Is Deuteronomy 17?
Believe me, after speaking to today, I don't even know.
Deuteronomy 17. Deuteronomy 18. John chapters 14 to 16. Right, and then we'll sit down and we'll study John chapter 16 together.
I'm just gonna give you advice. Just make sure you study and do your homework. Okay? That's my advice to you. It's time to go.
I will, bro.
Yeah?
It was nice talking to you. Do you have a New Testament at home?
Huh?
Do you have a New Testament at home?
I have a Bear Testament at
home. Is that a yes or a no?
I just told you I've got bears. What is that?
Honestly, to me, that slang I don't understand. What does Bear Testament mean? Does that mean you don't or you do?
I have multiple testaments at home.
Do you have the New Testament, though? I don't know what testaments you've got. Do you have the New Testament?
Are you saying, the King James Version?
The Christian New Testament.
Is that what you mean? The King James Version?
Whichever translation is relevant. You've got a Bible at home.
Yes.
Fair enough. Have a read of it. Come back and we'll talk again next week.
I don't need to read it again. Believe me, I don't.
So, are there any questions from people that
you need to read it? No, this is a recording.
Do you know what it is? I've got so many things to say, but it's too long right now. And this is only about the Bible. So I believe, basically, my whole purpose of this was today, have a little brief chat. Brief chat is because, as a Christian man himself, I would like to see him come more, promote more Christianity, make people come to Christianity. I'll tell you why. Me as a Muslim, I got no interest, because the part's not really for me. I've just come recently, and I would like to come.
Thank you for your service.
Pull out my Quran and talk about my Quran, my religion, and bring people to the truth. Instead of coming there week in, week out, looking for petty things, contradictions, that don't make sense. I ain't got no time for that because that's not my religion.
With respect, but isn't that what you've just done for the last time? No, with the greatest respect, but haven't you just done that?
Before we walked in, you said we're going to talk only about the Bible.
Yeah, nitpicking and trying to find contradictions.
I'm giving you I just told you my position that instead of me, so remember, think, I don't think you understand what I'm saying. I You do, this is what you do, day out, yeah, for years. I don't know how many years you've been here. 3 years.
Four.
That's a long, long time. Made anyone a Christian?
Yeah.
In the, on cam?
Yes is the answer.
Okay, good. All right. So, my future, my whole intentions will be just that. Come with my Quran. I don't need to carry no Bible.
Make people Christian. That'd be great.
Come with my Quran and bring people to my faith, stronger my unity, yeah? My unity, my community, in the truth. I don't have time to bring the Bible. This is why I said to you, this is a little light homework, what we're doing. I don't need to do no research, no nothing. But if we talk about the Bible again, I'll bring my notes. If that happens, yeah?
Okay.
But my intentions are to bring the Quran and speak about the Quran. I don't have no time, because you've seen me here a few times. Have you ever seen me hold a Bible?
I haven't seen you hold a Quran either.
See, that was a cigarette though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And a ladder.
Yeah.
Okay. So, that's it. I'll bring the Quran. I won't come with no Catholic books.
So when you come next.
Sorry, let me just finish quickly. Catholic books, the Guru Granth Sahib, the Sikh books, the Hindus, any other religion, yeah? I'm bringing my religion because I've got full faith in my religion. I don't have insecurity to bring the Bible and just talk about it all. Day in, day out.
So does that mean that you're...
I'm not insecure.
So does that mean, from what you're saying, that you're accusing all the Muslims that attack Christianity week in, week out as insecurity?
I'm not speaking for no one else.
I'm just saying, it would seem, from what you're saying... It would seem, from what you're saying, that you're condemning all the Muslims...
No, I'm not.
...that attack Christianity week in, week out.
You would hope
in their religion.
You would hope if I said that, yeah? Anyway, that's nothing to do with me, yeah?
Fair enough. What's your name, by the way?
Do you know my name?
I don't know your name. I'm sorry.
Adil.
Adil the Builder.
Adil the Builder. Nice to meet you.
New Builder.
Adil, can I give you a book? I'd like to give you a gift.
No, I don't take gifts.
It's a gift.
No, it's a gift.
It's not an offensive gift.
No, I don't take no gifts. I told you, I'm all good. It's all good to go.
I think you'll like it.
No, I'm not taking no gifts.
Don't be so quick. It's a nice biography.
I don't want to take no gifts.
It's an autobiography. It's not terrible.
No.
It's talking about some missionaries.
I was
just trying to be kind.
It don't appeal to me.
I was only trying to be kind. Mr. Rex, you've so kindly filmed us. You're gonna.
Thanks for the tea, Bob, as well. Yeah, Thank you for the tea.
Yeah.
Instead of everyone shouting, you know, trying to throw.
Mr. Rex, you know? Can I give you a gift, please? Yeah.
Go on then.
Yeah. Have you got a Bible at home?
Somewhere. Yeah,
somewhere. Do you know where?
No, I don't.
You reckon exactly. You can dig it out?
I've got a bookshelf, yeah.
You got a bookshelf. And your Bible's on there, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. This is a study guide into the Sermon on the Mount, which is the principal teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. Right? This is a study guide to sit there with your Bible there and your study guide here, and you sort of go through and reflect upon the teachings of Jesus for yourself.
Is the Bible not...
Don't be rude. I'm talking to him. This is your gift.
Thank you very
much.
Have a read
of it, and any sort of questions that you've got, anything you want to come back to me on, we'll have another cup of tea. It'll be my treat. As you can see, I take you to the best places.
I take you to the best places.
No, you're not paying for that.
And we'll sit down and we'll have another cup of tea, and I'll go through your questions.
This wasn't really my cup of tea, because if you can see, I never had a cup of tea.
Not for the lack of offering. Anyway.
I'm joking, next time, no. You ain't paying for nothing.
Anyway. Yeah.
If we do come again.
Yeah, I look forward.
It's on me next time.
Yeah, no, we're not paying, you're not paying again.
I look forward.
I appreciate that, thanks.
No worries, you're welcome.
For the water, whatever it was.
Enjoy.
But I like how they served it, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I mean, they stick it in a bottle like that just so they can charge you like £5.
I know, that's it, that's what it is.
It's probably come out of a tap.
Exactly how it is.
It's probably come out of a tap.
It's been good, isn't it? Like, instead of insults, everyone putting you down, Your book like this, your books like that. Just bring our own books and let's try our best to bring them into our faith.
And do you see that?
It's
more calmer in environment.
No insults. Big man team.
Right. Anyway, big man.
Nah, I ain't no big man.
You look after
handshakes.
You
boom. Box. Cool.
Goodbye, Mr. Rich.
See you later, Bob. Take
care. Have a good day. I'll
see you soon, man.
Small D.
No, sir.
Let me get some of this bar.
That's the only thing you've got one over me.
Nice place.
Alright, fair enough. Good day.
Yeah. Nice one, Bob. Take care.
You take care, Bob.
Nice one, a deal.